The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, and every day seems to be a bit worse than the day before. Insanity, people. That's what's happening here. So, yesterday, you know, thankfully, I'm on live at 5 o'clock Eastern each day. So, I have good reason not to tune in to Donald Trump's daily dump sessions in the White House briefing room, where the man is obsessed with the sound of his own voice and his power trip. So, yesterday, he's there. Taking questions from the reporters assembled. Now, because of COVID, the number of reporters in the room is cut down. But one of my favorite White House correspondents, Brian Karem, who is a CNN contributor and the senior White House reporter for Playboy magazine, asked a question. Here it is. Oops. It would help if I did this. Here we go.
Win, lose, or draw in this election, will you commit here today for a peaceful transferal of power after the election? And there has been rioting in Louisville. There's been rioting in many cities across this country, red and your so-called red and blue states. Will you commit to making sure that there is a peaceful transferal of power after the election?
Well, we're going to have to see what happens. You know that I've been complaining very strongly about the ballots, and the ballots are a disaster. And,
I did that, but people are rioting.
A disaster?
Do you commit to making sure that there's a peaceful transferal of power?
We want to get rid of the ballots, and you'll have a very peaceful, there won't be a transfer, frankly. There'll be a continuation. The ballots are out of control. You know it.
No, I don't.
No one knows it better than anybody else. The Democrats know it better than anybody else. Go ahead.
Mr. President, the second question is, will you...
Please go ahead.
And he cuts him off. He cuts him off and goes on to someone else because he doesn't want a follow-up question. So that's when Donald Trump blew the heads apart of everybody in America because he would not say that he promised there would be a peaceful transition as we've always had in the 240 some odd year history of these United States. Brian Karem's going to be joining us in a few minutes, but let me just tell you what happened. He was, his question today, Trump hasn't gone in for his daily dump as far as I know yet today. I don't know if he's going to or not. But Kayleigh McEnany, his trusted mouthpiece, did. And I don't watch those. I just don't go there. But a couple of reporters, I believe starting with Jonathan Carl, I think was the first one who asked. And then NBC's Peter Alexander picked up on it. And this is what happened today. Notice Kayleigh McEnany, and I know that's not exactly how she pronounces her name, but it's how I pronounce her name. She knows full well what Brian Karem's name is. But you'll hear in this clip, she refers to him as that Playboy guy.
Kayleigh, I wonder if you can just clean up or clarify something the president said yesterday. If he loses this election, can you assure us that there will be a peaceful transfer of power?
You are referring to the question asked by the Playboy reporter, right?
The Playboy reporter.
I'm referring to you with the president being asked if there would be a peaceful transfer of power, and he did not say yes.
No,
so I'm asking you, will there be a peaceful transfer of power if he loses this
election? I believe that question asked by the Playboy power. In fact, I think I have it right here. He was asked win, lose, or draw whether he would accept the transfer of power. I'm not entirely sure if he won why he would accept a transfer of power. That is maybe the deranged wish of that reporter,
oh
but that's not how governing
a very
works.
Very direct and very simple question. If the president loses this election, will this White House, will this president assure us that there will be a peaceful transfer of power? It's a very simple question.
The president... The president will accept the results of a free and fair election.
Always a qualifier.
I think that your question is more fitting to be asked of Democrats who have already been on the record saying they won't accept the results of an election.
Okay.
In fact, I have several of them here for you. South Carolina Democrat Jim Clyburn has said that Trump is not going to win fairly.
Okay.
Senator Barbara Boxer has said that the only way Trump will win is to steal it. That's according to Democrat Senator Barbara Boxer.
Barbara Boxer has not been in the Senate for over 2 years now. In fact, Kamala Harris occupies Barbara Boxer's former seat. So McEnany, get your facts straight. Jim Clyburn didn't say they wouldn't accept the results of an election. He just said Trump can't win fair and square, which I tend to agree with. Then she calls out Democrat Senator Barbara Boxer. First of all, it's Democratic. And second of all, she's no longer a senator, so what she says doesn't really matter, does it? But keep going, Ninny.
Boxer, the Washington Post has noted, they have a headline, Democrats may not trust the results of the election
not
if Trump wins.
Yeah.
And then you have that beautiful quote from Hillary Clinton that Biden should not concede under any circumstance.
Well, shouldn't.
So
okay.
I think your fitting is more question.
Your fitting is more
fitting
question
for Democrats. Yes.
Kaylee, just to understand this clearly, are the results legitimate
Peter Alexander.
If the president wins?
The president will accept the results of a free and fair election. He will accept the will of the American people.
So the majority, if he loses and it's free and fair, he will accept.
I've answered your question. He will accept the results of a free and fair election.
You notice she's got to qualify it. And of course, if he doesn't win, he'll say it's not free and fair. And how such a thing would work? Well, sadly, it is the topic of conversation today. Thanks mostly to that question asked yesterday by Brian Karem, who will join us in a few minutes, and an article in The Atlantic, oh my God, by Barton Gellman that you need to read. It's called, What If, hold on, I got to figure out where I am because I don't want to lose my place. I'm almost done. It's a very long article, but it's worth it. It's called The Election That Could Break America. And the subtitle reads, if the vote is close, Donald Trump could easily throw the election into chaos and subvert the result. Who will stop him? And I got to say, this is that dystopian future we've been worrying about for so long. I did pull some excerpts from this article. And one particular part I really want to share with you, I'm just going to keep looking over there to see when Brian Karem enters my Zoom room so I can bring him on and we can talk about what happened yesterday. I know he's very much in demand today, so he just messaged me that he's wrapping up the interview he was on before. We're nothing if not flexible here at the Nicole Sandler Show. Anyway, one of the, there was a clip, I don't have it pulled, but I just heard Randy Rhodes play it on her show on the Progressive Voices Network, and it was Donald Trump in Pennsylvania, telling the crowd assembled at his latest Nuremberg rally there that they're working on, putting the fix in on New York, whatever. We're going after it, whatever the hell that means. There's no way in hell Donald Trump is going to win New York. But he said, we don't have to worry about Pennsylvania. We've already got you. Well, in this article at The Atlantic, Barton Gellman explains what Donald Trump meant by that. And it's frightening. And it all goes to this notion. Let me back up here a little bit. And, I'm reading now from the Atlantic article and see if you can follow me on this. According to sources in the Republican Party at the state and national levels, the Trump campaign is discussing contingency plans to bypass election results and appoint local electors in battleground states where Republicans hold the legislative majority. Like here in Florida, this is me talking now, where there's more Democratic voters than there are Republicans, but Republicans hold all cabinet-level positions. They hold the governor's mansion. They hold the state Senate and state House. So they run all of the state legislative offices. That's what they're talking about. Back to the article, Barton Gellman writes, with a justification based on claims of rampant fraud, Trump would ask state legislators to set aside the popular vote and exercise their power to choose a slate of electors directly. Those are the people who actually cast the votes in the Electoral College. The longer Trump succeeds in keeping the vote count in doubt, the more pressure legislators will feel to act before the safe harbor deadline expires. It continues, to a modern Democratic sensibility, discarding the popular vote for partisan gain looks uncomfortably like a coup. Whatever license may be found for it in law. Would Republicans find that position disturbing enough to resist? Why should they now, right? Would they cede the election before resorting to such a ploy? No. Trump's base would exact a high price for that betrayal, and by this point, party officials would be invested in a narrative of fraud. And then it goes on. The Trump campaign legal advisor I spoke with told me the push to appoint electors would be framed in terms of protecting the people's will. Once committed to the position that the overtime count has been rigged, the advisor said state lawmakers will want to judge for themselves what the voters intended. Oh my God, it goes on. And there's more, and that's why I encourage you to read the article. I will post a link to it on my blog today at NicoleSandler.com/9-24-20, today's date, where I'll post today's show as well. But here, let me jump ahead a few paragraphs. In Pennsylvania, three Republican leaders told me they had already discussed the direct appointment of electors among themselves, and one said he had discussed it with Trump's national campaign. Lawrence Tabas, the Pennsylvania Republican Party's chairman, told me, quote, I've mentioned it to them and I hope they're thinking about it too. I just don't think this is the right time for me to be discussing those strategies and approaches. But direct appointment of electors is one of the options. It is one of the available legal options set forth in the Constitution. End quote. He added that everyone's preference is to get a swift and accurate count. Quote, if the process, though, is flawed and has significant flaws, our public may lose faith and confidence in the election's integrity. Well, you have a president, such as he is, who has done everything to cast doubt on the on the legitimacy of mail-in votes. There are states, Oregon and Washington State among them, who have voted exclusively by mail for years. There have been no allegations of fraud or abuse. There are states that send out ballots regularly to all registered voters. That's how they roll. That's how they've always done it. And again, there's no complaints. There's no investigation. There's no there's no accusation of voter fraud, except from Donald Trump, because he wants to put the idea of illegitimate votes in play. He wants people to question the veracity, the legitimacy of those votes when there's no reason to doubt the legitimacy of those votes, period, end of story. But this is the subject that everyone's talking about today. So it's interesting that McEnany walked back Trump's refusal to say, yes, I promise we'll have a peaceful transition of power if I were to lose, her use of a free and fair election gives her an out, because they lie about everything else. They can lie about this. Barton Gellman, the author of this Atlantic story, was on, he was on CNN last night. He was on Morning Joe this morning. Here's a little bit of him talking to Don Lemon last night, explaining how this scam, I'll use Donald Trump's words, how this election scam would work.
I did this piece in The Atlantic by starting with the proposition that President Trump is never going to concede defeat.
Now,
he could win a legitimate electoral majority, but if he doesn't, he will not concede defeat. And the system is surprisingly poorly designed to handle a president who won't concede. Concession is how we end elections. And Trump's plan is to halt the vote count with the day of votes, to litigate the rest into oblivion. And what I learned for this article, and describe in great detail, is that he and his people are talking about contingency plans to bypass the vote in each state. We think of electoral votes as just representing the results of the popular vote state by state. But the Constitution doesn't guarantee that.
Nope.
State legislatures have the power to appoint electors directly. And legislatures in six of the battleground states are controlled by Republicans. And the Trump campaign is talking about the possibility of asking those Republican legislators to disregard the popular vote because it has been rigged. And to simply appoint Trump electors to represent the state.
To appoint Trump electors to represent the state. Then he made, he made another interesting admission.
I scared myself with this story. I have never broken the fourth wall in a news article and stopped reporting in the third person and gone straight to talking to the reader. And I do that in this piece because I think it's so disturbing what I've discovered and so dangerous to the continuity of our democracy. That you have a president who is unwilling to accept defeat.
Right.
Insists, as he said today, just out loud, there won't be a transfer of power, there will be continuity of power. That everyone has to prepare for an election that is not normal, that is not the way we've been accustomed to having elections. And everybody has to understand, there is no umpire in an election. There is no singular official who can say to the loser, you've lost. And that's definitive, and the game is over.
Yeah.
The system isn't built that way.
The system isn't built that way. No, but the Republicans will do everything they can to skew it to their needs. All right, so I played for you the clip from yesterday where Brian Karem asked the question of Donald Trump, who, basically blew up democracy. Then today, played for you the clip where Kayleigh McEnany called him that Playboy guy. Well, the Playboy guy is here. He is the a senior White House reporter for Playboy magazine, as well as a CNN contributor, an author, a podcast host, and a singer. A coffee drinker and a singer. So you sing too, huh?
Yes, ma'am.
What do you sing?
Rock and roll, baby. We
really?
Have been in a band for a while and, you know, we love rock and roll.
Awesome. I do too. I want to hear your music. Do you do originals? Do you do covers? What do you do?
We have originals. We're mostly a cover band in the D.C. area and, get out and have fun when we can. These days a little hard, but we keep trying.
No kidding. So, Brian Karem, we hadn't seen you in a while in the White House briefing room. I'm sorry?
Good to be seen.
It's good to see you and yes, to be seen as well. And so when you go in there, what is the protocol now to get into the White House briefing room? Is there a lottery? Do you come up? Do you take turns? Because obviously that's like every fourth seat taken.
I have a hard pass that Donald Trump has tried to take away from me. And I understand that his chief of staff doesn't like me in there and has complained about me because I ask questions that, and I'll yell out a question to them and they don't like that. I don't care. I can go on any day, but if there is a briefing in the White House briefing room, there's only 14 seats available.
Wow.
It's the pool that is allowed in and no one else is. So I can't go in. I stand in the back of the room next to the OAN reporter who also doesn't have a seat. And I'm able to, ask a question from there or shout a question from there. Yesterday, there was an empty seat.
Oh.
And before anybody else could take that empty seat, I took that empty seat.
Awesome.
And I sat down and Donald Trump said, hey, ready for questions? I had my hand raised and he called on me. So I was, no one was more surprised about that than I was. I think I may have said, who, me? all right, strap in, big boy. Here's the question.
So did you have that question prepared ahead of time? Did you know that was what you were going to ask yesterday? If you had the chance?
Yeah, I usually go into those briefings with two or three questions on my mind. That one came because of the Atlantic had done a piece about Donald Trump, and I'd read it. So I was like, well, we need to ask him about that. And I have had that question kind of in the back of my mind for a while because he's never really addressed it directly. And it is a legitimate question that needs to be answered. So I that one was on my mind. The other one I had on my mind that I tried to ask him as a follow-up that he wouldn't.
He cut you off.
Yeah, it was about, before he cut me off, it was about Russia. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask him if he owed anybody money in Russia. And was that why he was so supportive of what they do? But he didn't, you know, I got the word Russia out, but that was about it.
I can understand. Well, you know, I'm surprised he called on you in the first place, knowing how he chooses his questions.
No one was more surprised than I was.
Right. And then today, I don't watch these things as they unfold, but Kaylee McEnany, I think it was one of the first questions out of the box.
I think it was John Carl,
right? Yeah. Who said, "Let's follow up on that yesterday." Because you made big news yesterday, and she had to qualify it, and she says, "Well, if it's a free and fair election, right." Which they're claiming that it's not because those mail-in ballots are so unfair.
So she kind of just doubled down and dug herself a deeper hole. And I've already put in my bio on my Twitter account, that Playboy.
I promoed you on Twitter saying that Playboy guy is coming up. She knows your name. She obviously knows your name, but you're that Playboy guy. By the way, I got to say, if you go to playboy.com, you've got a great piece up there today titled An Empty Seat and an Unhealthy Republic. There are some people who read Playboy for the articles.
Well, one would hope. I'm just the excuse people get for buying the magazine. My navel has never been stapled to a page, but you know, I'm there. So it's Playboy has a long history of covering politics and free speech in this country since 1953, and it was the founder Hugh Hefner who desperately wanted and had a goal not only to enjoy the sensuality of life, but to also mix it up politically and let everyone have a voice. And that's, some of the best writers of the 20th century found themselves in the pages of Playboy magazine. So I consider it a point of pride to write for Playboy.
And there have been some of the greatest all-time interviews. The John Lennon Playboy interview is one of the greats. I mean,
John Wayne Playboy interview. Boy, you didn't know he was a racist till you read that one.
There you go. Good old John Wayne. What was his? Never mind. You also, I want to give a plug for your podcast because you're getting some amazing guests, people that I can't get. You had Mary Trump on. Just ask the question, Doc. com is where people can find your podcast, and I saw you were just picked up by some big company. So you've hit the high life, huh?
You see how high life it is around here. I'm just the idiot who asks questions. Occasionally, I try to ask a good one,
and that's what it's all about. And
that's and it is. And that honestly, the podcast is called Just Ask the Question because the first time I walked into the White House briefing room, I met Helen Thomas.
Mm.
And Helen, she said, "I know who you are. You're a Karem." And I said, "How do you know who I am?" And she goes, "Well, do you know Peter?" And I go, "Well, Peter was my great-grandfather." And she goes, "Yeah, he brought my family to this country. Taking over to my house, I'm going to make you a good Lebanese dinner."
Oh, my.
And so we spoke there. And one of the things that she told me was, "Look, if you're looking for a friend in Washington, get a different profession, B, doesn't matter what the answer is. Just ask the question. They cannot answer it. They can answer it. You may not like the answer. But once the question is asked publicly, they can no longer deny that the issue has been brought before them. So, Brian, whatever you do, just ask the question." And the second person I met was Sam Donaldson. And he says, she's right. Now let me teach you how to yell so you get heard. Then Helen said something to Sam. And I think Sam said, hey, Helen, it's okay to have an unexpressed thought. And Helen said, Sam, when it comes to you, I have a lot of unexpressed thoughts. And it was off to the races. It was a great time to be at the White House.
That day was a day
that I remember forever. I mean, I watched Helen Thomas and Sam Donaldson beating on Larry Speaks, you know, upper press office going, hey, come out of here and answer some questions.
Wow. And that was in the day when, before all the niceties and the raising of the hands, that's when everyone shouted out and they'd call on somebody shouting out questions.
That was 86. Yeah. Wow. I'm old.
I'm old too. We're both old.
That's, okay. And that, you know, I met Ronald Reagan that same day.
Sorry.
That was, you know, what was really funny. I was up in upper press and apparently Reagan had wanted to come over to talk to Speaks. And he came over out of the Oval. And so the Secret Service is clearing everybody out of upper press, you know, because here comes the president, unbeknownst to anyone that he was going to do this. And so I'm being ushered out and I tripped and I fell. And as I got up, there was the president of the United States. And he goes, look, young fella, you don't have to bow before me. And I was like, sorry, Mr. President. You know, and I got up and got out of there.
Who were you working for then?
I was working for a television station in Lexington, Kentucky.
Oh, boy.
And I was there because we had done a series on illegal immigration. And so there was the infamous Simpson-Mazzoli bill back in the day.
Uh-huh.
And so I was there for just a few days at that point in time. And I was asking questions about immigration. And as much as I found Reagan, many of his things distasteful, today his immigration policy would be considered far left compared to what Donald Trump has done. And I never forget that. It's really changed in this country in that regard. I mean, there's no comparison. And you know, back in when I first went to the White House, that first time, you could drive pretty much up to the West Wing, drop your equipment off, and drive around the circle and leave.
Wow.
And everybody who did a stand-up, there was one tree. You know, now there's all these little cabanas.
Right,
but there was this one tree that all the lights were stapled to, and people would take turns doing their stand-ups underneath this tree on the North Lawn. And I see that tree today, and I have, you know, hey, fond memories. That's where I shot a stand-up.
All those years ago, and my how things have changed. Oh, yeah, yeah. So if you had to put up Ronald Reagan against Donald Trump.
Oh, please.
I'm sorry. That's a horrible thought.
Yeah, you could put Calvin Coolidge up against Donald Trump.
Yeah,
there's really been nothing quite like Donald Trump. He's such a small, insignificant person. If he wasn't the president of the United States, I actually would feel sorry for him.
Mm-hmm.
He seems insecure, angry, perpetually angry, and since November, that emergency trip to the hospital, increasingly lethargic, and I worry about his health.
He's not healthy. He is not healthy, and it's apparent just by
I'm standing next to him. I'm telling you, I'm in the same room with a guy. I know he's not healthy.
Wow.
And they lie about it, but I think the people who are on his staff want that second term real bad. And
I think they just don't want to go to jail.
Well, that's true for him.
Yeah. And some of his minions.
Yeah, well, I think there are plenty of them that will, and there's some of them that will be unemployable after
that's
this.
True.
There's just no other way around it.
That is true.
I mean, I just got such a kick out of Kaylee McEnany going, the Playboy reporter. Who the hell's going to hire her after she's out? I feel bad for all of them for making the career choice of being in that office.
Yeah, I don't feel bad for them, though, because they made that choice. I just wanted to be over.
Nicole, I'll tell you, that's true. You know, I had a conversation with his first press secretary when he left.
Sean Spicer.
Yeah, Sean. Yeah. And he said, well, Brian, I'll never forget this. And he said, Brian, what would you do if the president of the United States came to you and asked you to serve your country? And I said, well, when you put it that way, I would say, yes, sir, I would serve my country. But
I'm not going to lie for you.
That would end the moment he told me I had to go out and tell the nation that my inaugural crowds were a record when you could see they weren't. You know, clearly at that point in time, you're not working for the country. You're not serving the country. You're serving the interests of one man. And I could not do that.
No, nor could I. And there's a point where, you know, your integrity takes over. Either you have it or you don't. I mean, right. I saw Larry Kudlow, a video of him today when he was asked by a reporter, how many people are living in poverty today? And he said, I don't know. And the reporter said, wait, you're the president's chief economic advisor and you don't know how many people are in poverty? And he said, stop nitpicking.
Well, that's Larry. I've asked him similar questions. I was on the North Lawn with him. I was asking him about the bailout packages that, you know, they had put together. And he goes, well, he said, at some point in time, you know, all these people are just going to not work. And I'm going, Larry, you don't seem to understand that the money that you're giving people isn't going in their pocket. It's going in their pocket and out of their pocket just as soon as they get it.
Right.
He doesn't understand the working man or the working woman in the United States and does not understand their plight and quite honestly couldn't be concerned about it as long as his portfolio is fine. And look, I predicate that by saying Larry Kudlow is one of the few people in the White House I can actually talk to and get along with.
Really? Oh my.
Yeah. I mean, Larry is a kind person.
Yeah.
He's a genteel person. He'll talk to you. You may not like what he has to say, but he's not like the other people in the administration who run away from you and won't talk to you. Larry has always talked to me. You may not like what he has to say.
Is he drunk all the time? I mean, or is he just a dry drunk?
I saw him last winter come out on the North Lawn and hold a gaggle for about 30 minutes, and it was cold. It was extremely cold, and he had just come back from the hospital, and he stood out there, and, you know, God love him, he was, you know, trying his best.
Wow.
The problem with Larry Kudlow is he's not...
He's clueless?
He's clueless. That's the worst thing you can say about Larry.
Yeah, and it's true.
Yeah, the rest of them are soulless.
Wow.
And that's the difference. I don't think Larry Kudlow is soulless, but I think there are others in that administration that indeed are. And that starts at the top. And I think I think the president is just a very shallow narcissist.
Well, there is that. Brian Karem, it's great to catch up with you. I was thrilled.
I was late.
That's okay. It happens. I fumfered. But it was great. When I saw you asking the question, it's like, oh yeah, it's Brian Karem. And then you ask the question, it's like, thank you. Thank you for asking that and putting him on the spot. And congratulations for making news, because it was an important question that needed to be asked. Bookending it with the piece in The Atlantic by Barton Gellman. Oh, my God. A lot of people are kind of scared today, as we should be. Well, and not just scared, but ready to take action.
I think we should be concerned. But it's a sad state of affairs when the guy who asked the question, I really think... At the end of the day, the press corps is going to have to reassess itself and what it does, because those questions need to be asked, should be asked, ought to be asked and followed up on far more often than we do it. Part of it is because the coronavirus keeps our numbers down in the press briefing room, and thus Kayleigh McEnany and the president are able to manipulate us much easier than if that room were full and there were 100 people pressing. You wouldn't see that happen. But nonetheless, at the end of the day, we need to reassess who we put in that room, the questions that we ask, and what we're supposed to be doing there. And if we don't, then merely switching people in the executive office, we're not going to find a solution to our greater problem.
You are so correct. On that note, I got to run because I got another guest standing by. Brian Karem, it's great to talk with you. Hopefully you'll come back again soon. And
anytime you need it, and I promise I won't be late.
You got it. Thank you so much. It's great to see you. And
great to see you.
Thank you for your work.
Thank you.
Thank you for your service. All right. Take care. Bye-bye. All right. So now It is time for Howie Klein.
Are you a multinational corporation hungry for a treat? Well, come on down to Schmucky Chucky's, where you'll personally be seated by Chuck Schumer himself.
So many dishes, and they're all fresh.
You're gonna love our Blue Dog special, the Dino Burger, because we say so.
A good hamburger and French fries.
And every burger comes with a side order of
grits. I love grits. I love anything with corn. It's corn.
All for only $50,000. Wash it all down with a Dirty Debbie.
9/10 water, 1/10 orange juice. After a week or two, you drink this, it's 200 calories and it's acetic.
And wipe your mouth with a tissue print of Glass-Steagall. For dessert, try our DNC tarts.
Little cookies, tell the quality of that.
Most restaurants give you a mint, but at Schmucky Chucky's, you get complimentary.
Sweet and low.
Who picks up the tab for all this? Find out now with Howie Klein of DownWithTyranny.com on The Nicole Sandler Show.
Hello, Howie Klein.
Hello, Nicole Sandler.
I was having computer issues and I had to change the shots. Now I got to put audio on this clip. So anyway, I was talking with Brian Karem, the reporter who asked the question of Donald Trump yesterday about whether or not he would assure us that there will be a peaceful transition of power, and Trump couldn't say it. So Brian Karem is a great reporter, and Kayleigh McEnany today referred to him as that Playboy guy. Because he writes for Playboy, and he has actually got a great piece in Playboy right now that he wrote, posted today, An Empty Seat and an Unhealthy Republic, obviously along the lines of what so many of us are talking about today. Just crazy times. Did you read this article in The Atlantic that by Barton Gellman that everyone's talking about today? What if the election that could break America?
Yes, I read it very carefully, and I wrote about it in a post that I think is coming up soon. Or no, that maybe is up already. I think the post went up a few minutes ago. And it was. I found it ironic. Because just before that post, the Atlantic piece came out, Liam O'Mara, one of our candidates, who's running for Congress from Riverside County in California, he's a professor of history history of ideas.
Okay.
A professor of the history of ideas. He wrote a very, very long and interesting, although not as long as the one in the Atlantic, post about fascism and how actual fascism, what it is, and how it intersects with Trumpism. Hmm. And you walk away from his thing with the same kind of idea about how Trumpism is all about authoritarianism, and how there are a lot of people who want that, and that really, when it comes down to it, no one wants to admit it, but Trumpism is fascism.
It is.
So I would very much recommend that people go and read Liam's post as well. Obviously the piece in The Atlantic was amazing, and Liam's is really good as well. But the thing is that people have to know. I have gotten so many calls from people today who are just like freaking out. And the Atlantic post, what Gellman put up, is the worst possible scenario. I mean, I guess it could be even worse, but the worst possible reasonable scenario. It doesn't mean that's going to happen. I think that Gellman was really trying to frighten people so that they go out and vote and get everyone they know to vote, which is a good thing. But I'm not as pessimistic or as freaked out as most people are who read that thing. I think people are I admire what he did. I respect what he did. Uh-huh. I don't think that's what's going to happen.
Well, I hope you're right. But just laying out the scenario of states run by Republicans, like Florida is, deciding to override the popular vote in the state and put in their own electors, something that I believe the Supreme Court cleared the way for just a few months ago. This is a frightening scenario. And the fact that he quotes people from Pennsylvania, in that they've already discussed this scenario is scary. Now, David, my husband, was out and he just got back, and he said as he was driving, he heard, I think, the Speaker of the Pennsylvania Assembly on the air, maybe on CNN, saying this will never happen. You know,
and a number of Republicans came out today finally and said, you know, forget it. This is not going to happen. They publicly said it, both senators and even Liz Cheney. Now, I mean, the reason that Liz Cheney is important is not because of who her father is.
Right.
She's important because she is the chair of the Republican Congressional Conference. So, you know, it's not just some random person saying this. So they're coming out and saying, you know, Trump's crazy. Don't just ignore him.
Well, he is. And by the way, it was the Attorney General of Pennsylvania he heard, not the Speaker of the Assembly. But same thing. I'm glad some of them are speaking up. But look, I mean, I never thought the Republican Party would ever allow Donald Trump to become president. I mean,
I'm not saying that it's impossible that this happened, by the way. I'm just saying, you know, take a deep breath, calm down. It's not necessarily going to happen. It's not like, you know, written in stone. If I had a guess on one state, really going all the way into unconstitutional, it would be Florida. That's the place. I'm not just saying
right,
that because no. It's where you live.
Right, of course, because it's Florida.
You have a governor who certainly would want to do it, and you have a state legislature that is completely controlled by Trump and the governor and has no backbone and no feeling of any kind of patriotism towards this country whatsoever, none. And the Democrats, because of their own insipid way that they play politics, have no power in Florida whatsoever. So if there's one state that's going to do this, I would think it would be Florida, not Pennsylvania.
Right.
Pennsylvania is a problem, and it could happen. But I'm just giving you my opinion. Florida is the problem.
The thing about Florida, though, that is on our side, is, you know, on the side of good over evil, is that they actually start counting the votes as they come in. So, for instance, today, September 24th, Florida begins mailing out their absentee ballots. Hopefully, say ours is in the first batch and we get ours tomorrow. If we get ours tomorrow, we're filling ours in tomorrow, and David is going to take them down to the supervisor of elections office and put them in the box. So they will be counted. We can track it online to make sure the ballot was received and counted and all that. I think where this is going to be a problem is in those states that they don't begin counting until election night after the polls close. And that's why there's going to be a delayed response. And that's where they're talking about the problem coming in, which is in that period from November 4th to January 20th. I found your piece. It is posted at downwithtyranny.com. Mark your calendar. The interregnum ends on December 8th. We should know if America is still a democracy or not on that day, because that's the day that the electors cast their votes.
Yeah, I was being a little bit
facetious.
Not facetious. I was being a little overly dramatic.
Okay.
You know, and as he was saying it, and as I was hearing it, I was thinking, you know what? I'm not really being the most responsible journalist in the world, although I'm not a journalist. I'm a blogger. It's not the same thing.
All right.
But that's really what's happening, is that everyone is being a little bit overly dramatic. You know, I don't think we're going to turn into a fascist country. I think it's possible, but I don't think it's going to happen. I did another post. I don't even know if it's up or it's going up, but I finished it, about the Americans who really believe in authoritarianism. There's a very large percent. It's
really?
Almost one in five, not quite, but almost one in five Americans really do believe in authoritarianism, and not like, you know, kind of believe. That's the way that is what they believe. They believe that, you know, we need a strong leader who can override Congress and override the courts and override the Constitution. This is what they believe. So that's one-fifth of the voters who shouldn't be voting at all.
Right.
Well, you can't really take away their right to vote because of what they believe, but you know, these are absolute fascists. Most of them, not all of them, most of them are too stupid to understand where they're coming from. They're too stupid to understand that they're Nazis. Some of them very clearly understand they're Nazis, and they are proud of it. But some of them don't. And a lot of it is male, and a lot of it is in red states, but they're everywhere. Or in red areas. I shouldn't say red states. Red areas.
Right.
And that's a danger. I mean, that's the, you know, and they're armed.
Yes.
These are people that have, you know, 6 and 7 automatic weapons each.
Right. Well, you, like last night, you know, to segue onto another topic, last night people were out in force, not only in Louisville, Kentucky, but around the country. But in Louisville, Kentucky, they're walking around with their assault rifles on their arms because they're allowed to, because Kentucky is an open carry state. So you have people, you know, they're so freaked out about people in black and, oh, Antifa, people who are against fascism. But you have these white supremacists and their militias walking around with their assault rifles slung over their shoulders. And that's okay.
Yeah, it's scary. I mean, you're talking about Kentucky that has a good Democratic governor.
Yeah.
And I'm using good in a very, you know, very meaningfully. He is actually good.
I agree.
He's a little more conservative than me, but he's a good, he's a good guy who was the attorney general of the state and whose father had also been a governor. And we're talking about the you know, using them as an example of just absolutely something horrible. And we're not talking about a Republican governor,
right?
And yet this still happens.
Yep.
So yeah, I mean, look, there's plenty to worry about, and we can get people more freaked out. We can spend the whole half hour freaking people out.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'd talk about good news if I could find some. Ruth Bader Ginsburg died. What, I mean, can anything else go wrong this year? I talked on Monday. I came on, I think it was Monday. I decided this is the Murphy of years, like Murphy's Law. If anything can go wrong, it will. This is the year of the Murph. It's like, what else? It, kick me while I'm down. Just keep coming, 2020. I don't think anyone predicted 2020 would be the year of the Murph.
You're just determined to keep on this cartoon.
Well, dude, what good can we talk about? I mean, I have a whole list of things to talk about. Ruth Bader Ginsburg died.
Well, I know.
Right.
It's all terrible. But listen.
It's all terrible.
Did you watch the French Village, a French Village?
No, I never even heard of it. What is it?
Okay. It's a superb series. I think it went on, I think it was seven seasons.
Really? A French Village?
It's a French, it's a French film. You can watch it on, I think I watched it on Prime.
Okay,
yeah, it's not
we
Netflix,
have that.
Prime.
All right.
It's amazing. It's very, very well done. And the story is great, and the character development is great. And, you know, it starts in 1940 when the fascists take over France. And it goes, I mean, there are scenes towards in the very last season that are, I think, are in the 90s. I mean, it goes that far. I mean, after that, everyone is basically dead, but all the characters. But it's about all these characters, and the important thing, and the reason I'm bringing it up, is because what it does is it makes everyone think about what will you do. What will and shows what each character does if there's a fascist takeover. What will you do? Will you cooperate actively? Will you revel in fascism? Will you become a fascist yourself and turn Jews over to the authorities to be sent to concentration camps and kill resistance fighters? Will you be one of those? Or will you be more of a passive cooperator with the authorities? Or will you be someone who resists? Will you resist kind of passively, or will you resist all the way?
Uh-huh.
You know, there are, and when I say resist all the way, I mean, you know, actually put your life on the line by shooting fascists. And there's a whole, you know, there's a whole spectrum from, you know, just becoming one of them to killing them. And there's lots and lots of in between, and it shows the whole thing. That's why this really well done TV series is so worth watching, And I loved it. I watched every single episode. It went on for, you know, for me, it went on for weeks.
Right. If it's six seasons, a French village. All right. We're going to check it out because that's the kind of thing that David would like to. I tend to find these really offbeat kind of. There's another show on Prime that just started. I think it's called Upload. And it's like the future where when you die, you can actually upload your consciousness into this program and your wealthy friends or relatives can buy you a place so that you can still communicate via virtual reality with people alive. It's talk about escapism because sometimes we need that.
Yeah, I watched it as well. Unless there's a new season that you're talking about.
No, this is just the beginning. Right. I'm just now getting it. I watched it a couple of nights in a row when I couldn't sleep. So I found something on TV to, you know, try to get my mind off of the world. But it's a scary time we're in now. And I think, you know, the Barton Gellman article in The Atlantic talks about that time period, the word that I hadn't known before, the interregnum, which is the lame duck period, basically. It's the period from November 4th to January 20th. And I think we have two distinct time periods ahead of us right now through November 3rd, where it seems with each passing day, Trump goes a little further off the rails. And then the time between November 4th and January 20th, which I don't think is going to be any day in the park. I know I keep going back to the negative stuff. I can't help it. It's kind of where...
The reason that I brought up the French village wasn't necessarily to get away from what you're talking about, but it was just on people ought to think about how they're going to handle it personally. Right. In other words, the people who are listening to us today, everyone is going to have to make a decision. You know, all through history, I discovered this when I was in college, from my own experiences of running for office in college and running programs at my school, that, and then I started seeing the history of it Now, these are not exact figures, but approximately for anything, like let's just take the American Revolution as a beginning.
Okay.
About a third of the people who lived in the U.S. were revolutionaries. They wanted to throw the British out and have an independent country. Another third couldn't be bothered. They just didn't want anyone bothering them. They just had their business to do. They had their families to take care of. And, you know, you do whatever you want to do. Leave me alone. Leave me out of it. And then another third were pro-British, and they fought fought against the rebels. They were loyalists. Some of them left. Some of them, many of them left, and went to Canada, to the Caribbean, back to England. And all through history, that's what you get. You know, I mean, the way I found it was, you know, I was putting on I was the chairman of the Student Activities Board, and I was putting on these programs, whether they were very sort of cutting-edge music programs or they were, I was bringing people to the campus to speak, like Julian Bond, for example, and Timothy Leary. Wow. And what I found over the course of the almost 3 years that I did that was that, again, about a third of the people had no interest in seeing like a band like The Doors. They were brand new. They had an album out. They didn't have any hits yet.
Right.
And yet they were great, and people didn't want to see The Doors. Free, by the way.
Wow.
a third of the students had no interest. A third of the students were ready to kiss my feet for doing it. They were so happy and like loved it so much. And another third of the students wanted to hang me for doing something so horrible. And it was the same, the same kind of thing in support for Vietnam. Same thing. A third of the students were all for the war. A third of the students would do anything, you know, to get
avoid,
us out of the war.
Right?
And a third of the students were studying their engineering textbooks and didn't want to be bothered.
Right.
And you find it everywhere. And what's going to happen is, if I don't think Trump is going to do a fascist coup, but if he does, I mean, it's your premise, your show, your premise. If he does, what are we going to do? A third of us are going to, you know, bury their head in the sand and make believe it's not happening. It's not nothing to do with, and Roland, my closest friend, he's one of them.
Really?
He doesn't want to be bothered. He says, I mean, I don't know. I talked to him about it. He's not going to be bothered. For me, I'm the kind of person that, you know, will look for opportunities to right the wrongs, no matter what. You know, I'm not going to do something foolish like walk down the street with a gun and take a pot shot at a cop.
No.
But maybe I'll be hiding behind a bush and slit someone's throat or something. I'm not saying I will. I'm old now, but I would have when I was younger. And then another third of the people are going to be joyful. This is what yes. they want. This
oh,
is they're going to be absolutely love it.
And that's the scary part. I mean, the people who are, you know, who went from Illinois into Kenosha, Wisconsin with their guns so they can protect the property and then claim they shot and kill people in self-defense. Those yeah. are the ones, they love this shit. Oh, I'm in
they're
the militia.
The ones listening to your show.
No, they're not right? listening they're, to my
the
show.
The ones who are listening to us now are the other third.
Exactly,
third,
or two-thirds.
Ones
well,
have to decide how much resistance they're going to do. Are they going to be heroes the way the people of the French resistance were? On some levels, they were heroes. You got to watch the show to see how much the yeah. heroic they were.
Yeah.
Or are they going to be collaborators, or are they going to just sort of, again, be ostriches and not take it up? I think there's a value to asking our listeners to think about that scenario. So in other words, instead of freaking out, maybe you should take some target practice.
Well, you know, and I was just going to say that. I mean, I've had this discussion here on the show is what do we do? I've had the talk with David. I'm anti-gun. I've never allowed a gun in my house aside from, you know, riflery in summer camp when I was a kid. I've never fired a gun. But David's had gun training. He knows how to shoot. He knows how to handle a gun. And I'm seriously, with all this stuff going on, considering, do we need a gun? Should we have a gun in the house? My kid's not a kid anymore, and she's moved out. So it's just us. And frankly, it's a question that we're talking about because I'm freaked out about what's happening in this country. I see so many of those people and with the open carry stuff in Kentucky. Boy, that freaked me out. I can't even imagine that it's okay to walk down the street carrying an AR-15, yet, you know, if you're peacefully protesting, you'll get arrested. I just, it just doesn't make sense. And it's scary. And I think I said was I was a lot more depressed yesterday, something to the effect of, if it comes down to it, I don't want to live under a Donald Trump dictatorship. You know, I'd rather go down fighting. Let them take me out in the street protesting, but I'm not going to sit around and just let them have their way with us. Not that I have much of a say over it, but I'll do what I can. I mean, this is what I do here every day. I sit and swat at, you know, bigger targets.
Well, they'll shut you down. Don't worry.
Oh, of course they will.
Yeah, I mean, and we do what we can, and we should expand that to the worst. I mean, there is a difference between what happened to the French and what could possibly happen to us, in as much as they were occupied by a foreign power in half the country. So half the country, the Germans, it wasn't just an anti-fascist thing, it was also an anti-German thing. Your country is invaded by a foreign power. However, on the other side of the river from this French village, right on the other side, is Vichy France, which was just a fascist French power, no Germans.
Right, right.
So, you know, and that's more, more in sync with what you're expecting to happen, or you and Gelman are predicting might happen.
Well, I'm hoping it doesn't. What I'm hoping for, you know, if I can put it out there, I rarely get what I really want. I would like it to be such a landslide that on the night of November 3rd, even without the absentee ballot and the mail-in ballots and the provisional ballots counted, it's apparent that Donald Trump is going to go down to defeat in every fucking state. That's what I want.
Wyoming? West Virginia?
Well, that's
Oklahoma?
What I'm saying. That's what I want. I'm not saying it's going to happen. That's what I would like to see.
If you want to pray for something, pray for a cure for cancer.
Yeah.
But he ain't going to win. Biden's not going to win, a number of states.
I know.
The Dakotas, there's no chance.
Right.
Wyoming, like I said, West Virginia, Oklahoma, those states are in the bag for Trump. There's no. They want him.
Yeah.
They actually want what he is offering. That's what they want.
Which is astounding.
There are swing states. You know, I was reading this New York Times story a little while ago that came out today, which analyzed their polling in three red states: Texas, Georgia, and Iowa. And it's women. That's what it is.
Yeah.
The women are the ones who are the bulwark. They are standing. They are the wall that's keeping Trump from winning. Now he may win Texas, he may win Georgia, he's probably going to lose Iowa, and it's all women. I mean, that is that the gender gap in those three states, humongous, absolutely humongous.
All right, well, women, it's our year. Come on, let's do it. Let's send him home where he can't grab any more pussies. and on that note, we've reached the end of the hour. Howie Klein, sorry to
jail where he can't grab any more pussies.
you gotta grab onto something, not pussies, but you know something. Anyway, Howie Klein, thank you as always. I'll talk to you next week.
Thank you. Bye, Nicole.
Bye, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have a great night. Stay safe. Keep your head up. Bye.